Good morning. Welcome to Bay Area Unitarian Universalist Church. I am Reverend Katie McQuage-Loukas, and my pronouns are she and hers. Whoever you are, whomever you love, however you arrived here this morning in body or heart or mind or spirit, whether you're here with us in person or joining us online, and wherever you are in your spiritual journey, you are welcome here. If this is your first time, you are welcome here. If this is your 500th time, you are welcome here. We are glad that you are here, and we are glad to be together this morning. We begin with words from Reverend Gretchen Haley. We are keepers of hope, holders of memory, storytellers and song weavers pulling on this thread of truth. This other march of history that might otherwise fail to find its footing. That life is filled with kindness, bold beauty, courageous compassion, sacrifice for the common good, and a wide willingness to embrace neighbors and strangers as kin. We are here to do the work of hope, remembering the past, remembering ourselves, imagining our most possible future, for this life that teeters too often on the edge of forgetting. We belong to each other. Every hope, every fear for this radiant hour, bring all you are, every shadow and every light. Come, let us be hope for one another. Come, let us worship together.
Good morning. I'm Barbara Larson, and my pronouns are she and her. Ivar Larson will light our chalice this morning. The pollen has gotten to me, excuse me. Thank you. Symbol of light and knowledge, symbol of warmth and freedom, we light this chalice as a symbol of our faith. Here we gather to celebrate hope and the infinite possibilities of love. Thank you. Our opening song this morning is Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing, number 126 in our gray hymnal.
Oh,
Let us covenant with one another to keep faith with the source of life, knowing that we are not our own, earth made us. And let us covenant with one another to seek for an ever deeper awareness of that which springs up inwardly in us. Even when our hearts are broken by our own failure or the failure of others cutting into our lives, even when we have done all we can and life is still broken, there is a universal love that has never broken faith with us and never will. This is the ground of our hope and the reason we can be bold in seeking to fulfill the promise. Please join me in saying our covenant. Love is the doctrine of this church. The quest of truth is its sacrament, and service is its prayer. To dwell together in peace, to seek knowledge in freedom, to serve humanity in fellowship, thus do we covenant with one another.
Our responsive reading this morning is number 468 in the gray hymnal, We Need One Another. Number 468. Please join in with me on the italicized text. We need one another when we mourn and would be comforted. We need one another when we are in trouble and afraid. We need one another when we are in despair, in temptation, and need to be recalled to our best selves again. We need one another when we would accomplish some great purpose and cannot do it alone. We need one another in the hour of our success, excuse me, when we look for someone to share our triumphs. We need one another in the hour of defeat, when with encouragement we might endure and stand again. We need one another when we have come to die and would have gentle hands prepare us for the journey. All our lives we are in need, and others are in need of us.
Thank you. Good morning. My name is Gloria Miller, and I am the Director of Religious Education here at Bay Area. Our time for all ages today is Listen to the Language of the Trees by Tara Kelly. The forest was full of chattering. A jay shrieked at a sniffing coyote, and a squirrel scolded them from a low branch. The trees rustled as if whispering to each other. No one noticed the tiny seedling pushing its way above the soil. Quietly, its needles stretched out in the cool darkness of the forest floor. It was a miracle it sprouted at all. And as a seed, it had been tucked inside a seed cone hanging high on a branch of a giant tree until one day, the squirrel grabbed the cone and scampered down the tree. He buried it in a special spot for a winter snack. The seed rested underground for months, and luckily, the squirrel had a lot of special spots, and he never came back. Nestled inside its cone, the seed waited, and when it was ready, the seedling sprouted at the base of a giant tree. Centuries ago, this mighty tree was a tiny seedling, too, but now it towered over all the other trees in the forest. Strong and straight, it looked like it could survive anything. But no part of the forest is entirely free from danger. As small as it was, the seedling's roots reached underground and met the roots of other trees. Threaded between them was a silky net of fungi, a web that stretched from root to root and beyond. And through this web, the forest passed secrets. The trees talked to each other through their roots. They spoke of danger, of drought, and pests. They spoke of what one tree needed and another had to give. The seedling began to listen, and the giant tree with its huge crown gathered an abundance of sunlight. It soaked it up and turned it into food, and it took care to send that little seedling enough to nourish it. How did it know that the seedling was one of its own? It was a mystery, buried under the soil where their root tips intertwined. It was not only the tiny seedling that depended on that giant tree. The rest of the forest did too. Larger than all the others, the giant tree sent nutrients through the underground web. It brought water up from deep in the earth. It housed the owl that nested in its upper limbs and the coyote with its den at its foot. And day by day, the seedling inched taller. And then one night, everything changed. The sky came alive with lightning flashes. The forest swayed under the force of the winds and thunder roared in the sky. And tucked safely down below, the seedling's needles barely rustled until a massive strike lit up the giant tree's crown. Thud, down went an uppermost branch. The animals of the forest scattered. The jay shrieked, the squirrel ran, and for a moment, the giant tree lit up with an orange glow, and then darkness. And in the morning, it was quiet. The giant tree had been struck. It had burned briefly, but it still stood. But down on the forest floor, the seedling was missing one of its branches, snapped off when a limb had fallen from the giant tree. Otherwise, it had escaped harm. But something was different. A streak of golden light touched the seedling's needles. Instead of only drinking from its roots, it drank in the full light of the sun. And for the first time, the seedling could make its own food. After the storm, the animals returned to the forest. The squirrel began its seed cone collection again. The owl took a long nap, and the forest waited and listened. And that's when the first winged beetle landed. The beetle sent out an odor which said attack. And winging through the air, crawling over the bark, beetles clustered on that giant tree and laid their eggs. And the giant tree sent out an alarm, danger. The warning pulsed through the forest, passing through the tree roots, carried by the web of the fungi. And day after day, the beetles attacked. No more sugar flooded the underground web from the giant tree. Just distress. And then something unexpected happened. Through the threads of fungi from root tip to root tip, nutrients flooded, not out from the giant tree, but toward it. The forest gave what it had so the giant tree might live. And it did. Someday, with luck, the seedling would grow tall too, but for now, it drank deep through the web at its roots and waited and listened as the forest talked. The keeper of our flame today is Jace Beveridge.
This is possibly the most sacred moment in our Sunday morning gatherings, because we come bearing all that we are as human beings, all of our sorrows, all of our joys, worries, and hopes. We come holding milestones, celebrations, changes in our lives, and we bring these things here because here we are not alone in them. Others celebrate with us, others grieve with us. Here we know that we are not alone. I invite you to come forward now as you are moved to light a candle. You may light one for yourself, for a loved one, for the state of the world. Whatever it is you bring, know that we will witness it and hold it with you for a time. If you need a candle brought to you, please raise your hand.
Thank you.
This morning, I offer something that is both a prayer and a meditation by Matt Alspa. It is a meditation on breathing. Breathe with me, in and out. Breathe with me, the breath of life. Inhale, inspire, inspiration, Ruach, Pneuma, Spiritus, the Holy Spirit, the many names for breath. Breathe with me. Know that each breath we take in molecules of air that were breathed by every person that has ever lived. Breathe with me. And breathe the breath of Jesus, of Moses, of Muhammad, of the Buddha. Breathe with me. And know that we are all interdependent, that the spirit of life flows through us all. Breathe with me. As we come together to do the holy work of interconnection and relationship, that our work here may be blessed. Amen, and may it be so. And now please remain seated for our meditation hymn, Find a Stillness.
This is part of a review of David Graeber's and David Wingrove's historical doorstop of a book, The Dawn of Everything. The story goes like this. Once upon a time, human beings lived in small, egalitarian bands of hunter-gatherers, the so-called state of nature. Then came the invention of agriculture, which led to surplus production and thus to population growth as well as private property. Bands swelled to tribes and increasing scale required increasing organization, stratification, specialization, chiefs, warriors, holy men. Eventually, cities emerged and with them, civilization. Literacy, philosophy, astronomy, hierarchies of wealth, status, and power. The first kingdoms and empires. Flash forward a few thousand years, and with science, capitalism, and the Industrial Revolution, we witness the creation of the modern bureaucratic state. The story is linear. The stages are followed in order, with no going back. Uniform, they are followed the same way everywhere. Progressive, The stages are stages in the first place, leading from lower to higher, more primitive to more sophisticated. Deterministic, development is driven by technology, not human choice. And teleological, the process culminates in us. It is also, according to Graeber and Wingrove, completely wrong. The authors write their chapters on cities against the idea that large populations need layers of bureaucracy to govern them, that scale leads inevitably to political inequality. Many early cities, places with thousands of people, show no sign of centralized administration, no palaces, no communal storage facilities, no evident distinction of rank or wealth. But the author's most compelling instance of urban egalitarianism is undoubtedly Teotihuacan, a Mesoamerican city that rivaled its contemporary imperial Rome for size and magnificence. After sliding toward authoritarianism, its people abruptly changed course, abandoning a monument building and human sacrifice for the construction of high-quality public housing. Many citizens, the authors write, enjoyed a standard of living that is rarely achieved across such a wide sector of urban society in any period of urban history, including our own. Is civilization worth it? The authors want to know. If civilization, ancient Egypt, the Aztecs, imperial Rome, the modern regime of bureaucratic capitalism enforced by state violence, means the loss of what they see as our three basic freedoms, the freedom to disobey, the freedom to go somewhere else, and the freedom to create new social arrangements, or does civilization rather mean mutual aid, social cooperation, civic activism, hospitality, and simply caring for others?
If any of you have ever read David Graeber's work, you know how impossible it is to excerpt it directly. There's simply too much there. So excerpting a review was about as coherent as I could manage it. I'm sure that at some point along the way, many of you have encountered William Golding's Lord of the Flies. Maybe you were assigned it in school, as I was. Maybe you saw the movie at some point. The story is fairly straightforward. There's a plane crash. British schoolboys are stranded on an island, and things begin in a manageable way. They agree on how they're going to be together. They make plans for a fire and smoke signals and the like. But by the time the end of the novel arrives, some of the boys are dead. The island is a disaster. Those who would lead by fear and violence won the day. The book was published in 1954. Golding had served during the Second World War, and he went on to become a schoolmaster in post-war Britain. And it's clear to me he was working through ideas about human nature with regard to his war experiences and Nazism. And I would suggest that attempting to interpret human nature through the environment of a British boys' school might not have been the best plan. So he writes this book about what happens when British boys are alone on an island. And in any case, reading the book at some point prompted Dutch historian Rutger Bregman to start looking for real-life examples. What would really happen in this scenario? And in his research, he found a story from 1966. It turns out that in real life, when a group of boys are stranded on a deserted island, they do okay. Our story comes from Peter Warner. He was an Australian heir to a large fortune who ran away to sea, and he worked his way up to captain, I believe, in the Swedish Navy. And he came home to rejoin his father's company and then ran away to sea again a few times, as you do. And when he did finally settle down, he couldn't quite let go, and he had a fishing fleet he'd go out with periodically. While making a detour near Tonga, he saw a small island in the distance with charred vegetation, and that seemed odd. That island was uninhabited, so he sailed closer. And then he saw a naked boy with long hair run and leap into the sea. And then a few more followed, and they swam out to his ship, and one of them said in perfect British English, "My name is Stephen. There are six of us. We reckon we've been here 15 months. It turns out that 15 months ago, six boys had run away from their boarding school on Tonga. They borrowed a boat. There was a storm. They drifted, and they ended up on this small island. Captain Warner wrote, the boys had set up a small commune with a food garden, hollowed out tree trunks to capture water, a gymnasium, a badminton court, chicken pens, and a permanent fire, all from the work of their hands, an old knife blade, and much determination. When one of the boys, Stephen, broke his leg, the other boys set it, and they took care of him until he was strong again. One of the boys cobbled together a guitar out of a coconut shell." And this is not quite a perfect tale of caring human nature. It takes a little while to get to the happy ending. Even as their families were celebrating their homecoming, having held funerals a year ago, the boys were arrested and jailed for stealing the boat. So our captain, and the reason we know his name, Captain Peter Warner, heir to a radio fortune, called the media. He sold the Australian story rights and used that money to pay off the boat owner, and then started his own fishing company with the six boys as his deckhands. One of them sailed with him for decades. And the captain was a larger-than-life figure. We don't just remember his name for this. This is not the only time he even rescued castaways. So he stands out in our narrative, and we remember his name. But those six boys, ranging, I believe, from 13 to 17, their ordinary, everyday care for one another is the real story. We can't toss out Lord of the Flies. History is sufficiently full of tragedy and conflict to support a conception of humanity as containing violence and selfishness. And that's what we write stories about. We don't write stories about a lack of conflict. We write stories about conflict and competition and large personalities with flaws. A story without conflict, something simple, something straightforward, that's just everyday life, isn't it? After disasters, so often, people come together to take care of one another. After personal loss, communities support grieving individuals. We feed each other. We take care of each other's pets. We do favors for one another without keeping track or keeping score. It's just our everyday life, and it's something we often take for granted. We don't always realize that there are at least as many, if not more, stories of cooperation, mutual care and solidarity as there are of conflict. But the conflict cannot be denied. Just last night, Iran sent missiles to Israel in retaliation for Israel's attack on its embassy, in retaliation for. And we also know all the everyday stories of unkindness, of betrayal, of racism, sexism, ableism, of fighting for advantages, and yes, of violence and war. So who is it then that we are? Who are we at our core? Philosophers talking about this question talk about the state of nature, what it is that we human beings are or would be before we are socialized and civilized underneath all those added layers. And on one side stands Thomas Hobbes, who says that the natural state of humanity is solitary, poor, nasty, brutish, and short, a quotation that has been engraved on my mind for ever since I read it in school. And so he says that to attain some measure of peace, we get together, we find a strong leader to carry out violence on our behalf to keep us safe and preserve a measure of order. Order is of paramount importance to Hobbes. And on the other side is Jean-Jacques Rousseau. And he argues that people are only nasty in civilization because of civilization, and that people are essentially blank slates, and that it is learned behavior. In our natural state, we're a little bit more solitary, and we're more likely to be free and happy because we avoid property disputes and other forms of conflict. And there's a theological version of this argument too. Are we made in the image of the divine, flawed but still essentially good and beautiful? Or have we been truly broken along the way so that we have to work and fight and strive to be good? And both of these ways of framing the question rely on a linear narrative and on individual action and reaction, that we're born a particular way, that we are shaped by the world we live in as individuals, with individual needs and individual goals, and those goals come in conflict with the goals of other individuals. But who we are is not actually entirely individual. Reality is a little bit messier, and there's a lot of pieces of us inside that are perhaps in conflict with one another and get brought out in different ways. Rebecca Solnit often writes about the more hopeful side of history. She writes about climate justice, too, and other ways to think about how we are together. And she writes, "The modern right may wish that every man were an island, entire of himself, but no one is wholly independent. You can't survive without taking air into your lungs. You did not give birth to or raise yourself. You won't bury yourself. And in between, you will not produce most of the goods and services you depend on to live. You are full of microorganisms, without which you could not digest all the plants and animals likely grown by other people on which you rely to survive. We are nodes on intricate systems, synapses snapping on a great collective brain. We're in it together for better or worse. Of course there is such a thing as society, and you're inside it. Beyond that, beneath it, and above, and around, and within it and us, there is such a thing as ecology, the systems within which our social systems exist, and with which it often clashes. We are always social beings. There is no state of nature, a theoretical, unsocialized self. We're wired for connection. We figure out our sense of self through engagement and interaction with others. We learn the shape of the world in the company of others. And we grow to become active participants in shaping the world ourselves. Our reading today reminds us of our role in actively shaping our societies and our histories. It reminds us that we have choices. Our ancestors made choices before us, and our descendants will make choices after we are gone. And we do it as individuals sometimes, but we do it often as groups. The groups we're born into, the groups we create, the groups we encounter, we are all embedded in infinite systems, layers upon layers of interactions and interweavings. Some of them we can trace, many of them we'll never know. We'll take them for granted. Historically, the Unitarians have been on the optimist side of the debate. The belief that people are basically good and that we can be educated to be better at being good and that we can work for good. And I do not think that our forebears are wrong. And my initial plan for today was to lean into biology and ecology and interdependence that creates mutuality and cooperation, to remind ourselves that it is just as much our birthright as any striving and competition and conflict. And it turns out it's really hard to write a triumphant sermon about the better angels of our nature when bombs are once again falling, when they are kind of always falling, and that any Sunday morning could include a conversation about that. And so I think it's important to hold on to what James Luther Adams calls the tragic nature of history, the idea that we are made up of survival instincts that can go two ways. We contain the will to power and the will to mutuality at the same time. And they both arise out of that same urge for life. But the urge can manifest as violence, or it can manifest as cooperation. The great tragedy of history is that it could have been different. Again, Rebecca Solnit, this time not an essay, but in her book, A paradise built in hell writes, "Who are we?" In times of crisis, these are life and death questions. Thousands of people survived Katrina because grandsons or aunts or neighbors or complete strangers reached out across the Gulf Coast, and because an armada of boat owners as far away as Texas went into New Orleans to pull people to safety. Beliefs matter. What you believe shapes how you act. And how you act results in life or death for yourself or others, just like in everyday life, only more so. And she observes that in the wake of an earthquake, a bombing, or a major storm, most people are altruistic, engaged in caring for themselves and those around them, strangers and neighbors, as well as friends and loved ones. The image of the selfish, panicky, or regressively savage human being in times of disaster has little truth to it. It's important to remember that that is just as true. And so the tragedy of history is that none of our individual choices may seem to mean much, but we do have them, and they do add up to become something greater. And so at some point along the way, someone, probably many someones, could have made different choices, and we would be living in a different world. Just as Teotihuacan chose to tear down their centralized monarchy and build something egalitarian. I repeat, it could have been different. Respect for the interdependent web is not merely an ecological statement, though it is a statement of ecological fact. But it is also an affirmation that we are more than individuals. And at the same time, it has a vision embedded in it of what the world could be. As part of the proposed revisions for Article 2, the section on interdependence includes acknowledgement of the underlying reality that we are embedded in a web of life, but it also makes a clear moral demand. In its new proposed form, it, yes, calls us to cherish what currently is, but also to create more relationships, to nurture relationships, and to repair damaged ones. This is a demand upon our moral agency, calling us to make different choices than we perhaps have made in the past. This acknowledges our capacity for choice in either direction, our capacity for harm, and our capacity for repair. And so on this Sunday morning of appalling headlines, and again, how many Sunday mornings could we say that? I think there is hope in the balance we can strike between power and mutuality. As horrifying and difficult as it is to grapple with our capacity to do harm, with the reality of evil, it is important to hold just as firmly to the truth that this is not inevitable, that evil is not supernatural. We are simply human beings, and it is a piece of human nature. And there are other pieces. There is kindness and compassion. There is love. There is longing for justice, and there is altruism as well. And these things are just as real and just as much a part of us. And if we hold fast to a vision of the ecology of the interdependent, interconnected world, where each of us is connected to all of us, how could we choose otherwise than compassion and justice? I would like us all to take a moment to pause in silent meditation in whatever way best suits your spirit. For some of you, it may be loving kindness meditation, perhaps centering prayer, perhaps simply being quiet. However you turn your mind and heart toward compassion and justice, I invite you to do so now. I close this morning with a portion of a prayer in honor of St. Francis, which may be familiar to some of you. Make me an instrument of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me sow love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light. And where there is sadness, joy. May we remember always how many people there are in the world who are ready to help, ready to build something better than what we had before, and ready to take care of each other. May we recognize the instruments of peace and love all around us, and may we strive to be those ourselves. May it be so. And now may the offering be given in a generous spirit, and it will be received with a grateful heart. Please join me in the blessing of the offering. This gift from the abundance of my life blesses me, our ministries, and the world. And now we have some announcements, and I'm going to do the first couple, and then we'll switch off. So my first announcement, there's not a slide for. I'll just say quickly that if you missed the art festival this weekend, well, I'm sorry, you missed out on a good time. But you can, I think, still bid on some of Don and Gay's collection, which is down in the RE wing over towards Cockrell Hall. So go check it out after church. There's also treats from the bake sale that are still left that I encourage you to eat so that the staff doesn't eat them all. Because I would. So, if you have not yet turned in your pledge, please be sure to get it in as soon as you can. So far, our number is, as of writing this down on Friday, $341,241. That is 92% of our goal of 370. And there are still pledges that have not been turned in. So I believe in my heart that we can make it to 100%. You can do that online at bauuc.org. There's a pledge now button at the bottom of the screen. You can use that QR code on the screen now. And in the back, in the parlor, there are some blank cards you can fill out on the spot and drop in the box. So please do so, so we can start nailing down our budget for next year.
And to continue the announcements, do you want your child to be responsible and self-motivated? Preferably without yelling and nagging all the time? Join us in family fellowship this afternoon at 12:30 in Cockrell Hall for a parenting seminar based on the internationally recognized work of Dr. Gary Landreth. Dr. Landreth has published more than 150 journal articles, books, and videos, as well as receiving the Lifetime Achievement Award from the Association for Play Therapy. The discussion will be led by our own Christy Stanton, who has her master's in marriage and family therapy. This will be an interactive and fun experience. Don't miss the opportunity to connect with other families in a supportive environment and enhance your parenting journey, or parenting. We ask that you bring a potluck dish to share. I'm not sure how that's going to work since you're supposed to meet at 12:30. Anyhow, we'll work it out. Calling all middle school and high school youth, come hang out with us this Saturday, April 20th, at 4 p.m. in the youth room. There'll be games, food, and friendship. It's a good way to connect with other youth. All middle and high schoolers are welcome. Next Sunday, April 21st, join us in getting down and dirty for Earth Day. We will be hosting a unique dirt communion during the time for all ages. Bring a piece of your garden or dirt from a place that's special to you. Let's come together to share in Earth's bounty. It's a communion like no other. After today's service, please be sure to join us in Cockrell Hall for coffee and some light snacks and fellowship. All are welcome. And if you're not on our email list, you can sign up on our website at bauuc.org. We send out an email of BAUUC news and events every Tuesday, and it contains these and many other activities that are happening in our church. And I have now forgotten what our closing hymn is. Thank you. We would be one, number 318 in the gray hymnal, verses 1 and 2.
Thank you.
Reminded that we are part and participants of the universe, let us go forth from this hour, encouraged to strive toward faithfulness to the best in ourselves, in others, and in the whole creation. Blessed be, and go in peace. Amen.